his name, Venerable was the name of the man, who had two lumps on his neck. So he called him and said, I think I can remove these lungs without giving any pain for surgery. The man refused to have any surgery done because of the pain that would come if you allow me to give you this particular thing. So the fellow agreed. And that was the first time that under ether, just poured in a handkerchief, over a handkerchief ether, and removed the two lumps on his neck, and the man had no pain at all. And he makes an entry into a book which is apparently still there, can still be seen. This was in the southern states of America, in Georgia, saying, two tumors removed, charge $2. That was the entry that was made. And apparently also continued to give this to many of his patients. But he was a sleepy old chap, and he never reported it. He never told anyone about it. But the fact that the entries had been made, so they were really authentic, he was not bluffing. But he didn't tell anyone anything about it till well after the discovery, authentic discovery of anesthesia was made. But many people, to many, many people today, the discovery of anesthesia was to this man, Crawford Long. There was a dentist. His name was Wells, Horace Wells. He was also a partier, and he was also used to go to all these road shows and shows, etc. One day he went to this sort of a show where they were giving nitrous oxide and making people laugh, etc. And the man next to him volunteered to get nitrous oxide. And he behaved crazily, fell down, etc. And ultimately went and sat down back in the seat next to Wells. Wells said, this is amazing. So he called the owner of the chap who started, who gave this show, and said, can you please give me some ether? Because I want to see if I can have a tooth removed without any pain. So he said, yes, I'll come along with you. So he goes to his clinic. Wells calls one of his colleagues. The fellow who had given the show pours ether down in a handkerchief again, and the colleague yanks out one of the tooth of Wells. He didn't mind losing one tooth to prove to himself, you know, that there was no pain. And when it comes out, and this is again authentic, he says, oh gosh, this is the greatest discovery ever. I didn't even feel the prick of a pain. Now he was an ambitious character. So he said, I'm going to make lots of money. Just imagine finding something where a surgeon can operate without producing any pain. I'll make lots of money. He wasn't a wise chap. He was money oriented for sure. So he writes to the Mass General Hospital, one of the first hospitals at that time in the United States, in Harvard, saying, telling the chief surgeon, and I want to give a demonstration where I can pull out a tooth without producing any pain. So the Mass General was surprised. Pull out a tooth without producing any pain at all? All right, come, let's give the demonstration. So Mr. Wells, or Dr. Wells, goes to the Harvard Medical School. The auditorium is there, there are people watching, etc. And he said, any volunteer who wants a tooth pulled out. So one poor student who said, well, a bad tooth, says, I'll come. So Wells gives him the ether and he yanks out the tooth. But the student screamed with pain. You know, so there was hushed silence that this fellow is an imposter. He said there would be no pain, and this fellow screamed with pain. And there was a big shout and a big fight at which Wells ran away. He ran away from there and was very depressed. Very depressed. And in fact, after a period of time, he killed himself, the stupid chap. And he killed himself in a funny way. He opened his veins and inhaled ether. Now, opening veins, as you know, I don't know if anyone of you know, opening veins and dying was the most famous way of committing suicide amongst Romans. I don't know if you know that. What they used to do is to sit in a hot tub and have their slaves open their veins. Not a huge vein like the femoral vein or something. The veins in the upper limbs, mainly. Open the veins. Open the veins in the legs, etc. Sit in a hot tub. And they said it was the sweetest death that you could ever have. A very gentle, slow, dreamy death. As you slowly lost blood and died. Anyway, this is what he did. Now comes the man. The hero of the story. Dr. Wells had an assistant. And his name was William Morton. saw what had happened. And he realized that there was a point in what Wells was trying to do. But he was a wise chap. He had by the time worked his way into the Harvard Medical School, and passed out of Harvard Medical School. And in Harvard Medical School, there was a chemist also on the faculty. And the chemist tells him, why don't you try ether yourself? I have a feeling that it will take away pain and therefore can be used in surgical operations. So he decided to try. And just as charity begins at home, his experiments began at home. He took his wife, his children, his dogs, everybody for a holiday with one specific purpose, to see how ether would work on them. He didn't do anything to his wife, but he first anesthetized the dog, who went to sleep for a long time to the horror of his wife. Then there was some goldfish. He anesthetized the goldfish to the horror of his wife. And the wife had to, he threw the goldfish quickly into the water, and fortunately they revived. And then he went and anesthetized every creepy, crawly creature that he could find to show that ether could put people to sleep. When he went back, he anesthetized himself, and that was the best part of it. And he was found sprawled out on the floor. And then he said, he started to anesthetize quietly other patients of his also. And the first patient that he got was again a chap called Eben Frost. He also had a bad tooth. And Morton pulls out the tooth, the patient has no pain. And he becomes his mascot. Eben Frost follows Dr. Morton all over the place, see how good this doctor is. He took out my tooth and I had no pain. That's how it was. Now he writes to the Mass General Hospital, to the chief surgeon there. What was his name? His name was Collins, John Collins, the chief surgeon there, that I wish to give a demonstration. If you have any surgical procedure to perform, I will give a substance which will end in the patient not experiencing any pain. So this surgeon says, all right, you want to try it out? Fine. So we give you a date, we give you a time. He gives a date, I think it was sometime in October or something, I think it was 1864, and it was in October, I forget the date. Gives you a date, gives you the time. So there it was. Now, Morton decided to have some sort of equipment whereby he could deliver this ether properly. So he tells his instrument maker to do so. The time comes, the day comes, but the instrument maker is not ready with the instrument. So he was furious with him, and they are struggling to get the instrument ready. News goes around in the whole of Harvard that there is a new procedure going to be performed, a new awakening in medicine and surgery. Everyone gathered. And you got that picture? And there is a famous picture. This is the amphitheater of Harvard at that time. The patient is wheeled in, a thin, consumptive looking fellow, very pale, with two lumps in the neck. The surgeon comes, the patient is put there, and everybody waits in hushed silence. The time for Dr. Morton to appear has passed. He hasn't come. They wait for 5 minutes, they wait for 10 minutes, they wait for 15 minutes. And then the surgeon says, since Dr. Morton has not presented itself, it appears that he must have been otherwise engaged. Now, no American, as you know, would say that. This is a typical sentence of a Britisher. Very sarcastic and underplayed. The American would say, to hell with Dr. Morton, come on, let's go ahead. Isn't it? But you must remember, this is Boston. And Boston at that time was largely inhabited by people who had come over from Britain. So it was a British remark. At that very moment when he was about to start the surgery, poor Dr. Morton rushes in. I'm very sorry, sir. My instrument maker hadn't the instrument ready. It is now ready. I'm ready. So very sarcastically the surgeon says, doctor, your patient is ready too. And then Morton explains to the patient that this is what has happened, you will have no pain. And he is, of course, with him, his famous mascot, Even Frost. And Even Frost then talks to him, I had my tooth pulled out, and I tell you, mister, there was no pain, no pain at all. But the patient is happy, and then they start. So he puts a tube within his mouth and asks him to inhale. He inhales the ether, and he, after a little convulsive movement, falls asleep. And then Dr. Morton tells the surgeon, sir, your patient is ready. Surgery is done, the two tumors are removed, stitches are put, the patient at last wakes up. And he says, no, I felt no pain. I felt no pain. So there was a loud cheer from all these people who are looking here. I can't in this, you know, make out very poor Even Frost is. I tried my best, which is Even Frost here. But I can't seem to make out where he is. You know? But and then again the understatement of the year when he says, when the surgeon says, gentlemen, this is no humbug. That means he at last was a great thing. Now the surgeon, the chief surgeon immediately asks the instrument maker that we want it for our surgical work in our theatres, etc. But the instrument maker says, sorry sir, I can't give you this because there is a patent right on this taken out by Dr. Morton. So the surgeon was furious, absolutely. Absolutely furious. So he writes to Dr. Morton and he writes to the instrument maker, in that case we will not allow this to be used at all. And I must say, to the credit of the person who discovered it, that is Dr. Morton, he immediately writes back to him, I'm sorry if the instrument maker has said that, you can please use it and use it freely for all surgical work in the hospital. Now you would think that everything was fine, but no, unfortunately there became a great controversy. Jackson, the man who told Morton that you should use ether for your surgical, for anesthesia purposes, he claimed that it was I who discovered. And I said that this was going to be. Then poor the dentist went till then killed himself, Mr. Wells, Dr. Wells, Horace Wells. He said, I was the first person to pull out a tooth where the patient had no pain. So I should be the discoverer of anesthesia. And this controversy raged for a long time. Poor Dr. Morton was quite mortified. You know, he had given up his practice to work on ether in anesthesia. He'd become a pauper for all practical purposes. And he died at the age of 48. Ultimately, the discovery of anesthesia is laid at the doorstep of Dr. Morton. Now, interestingly, how did the term anesthesia come along? That's it. Anesthesia was a word used by the ancient Greeks in the time of Plato. You know when that is? That is somewhere in 300 BC, after Socrates came Plato. And a person called Dyskonioides, a twisting word, a Greek person, who said, Dyskonioides said, that if you take this portion of mine, that's I'm talking of ancient Greece, you will have no pain in any surgical procedure. And what was this portion? It was said to be mandrake, the roots of mandrake, which is again apparently an opioid, you know. You boil it with wine, so that it comes to a quarter of what it was and give it to the patient just before anesthesia and he will be anesthetic, he will have anesthesia. Anesthesia in Greek, it's a Greek word which means insensitivity. So that's how the word anesthesia came along. I've seen some anesthetists calling anesthesia anesthesia. Now that's wrong. Anesthesia, if you all know, was one of the daughters of Tsar Nicholas, who was killed. They were all killed from the orders of Lenin at the time of the Russian Revolution. And Anastasia became very famous because they found the bodies that they could identify all the children but couldn't identify Anastasia. And as a result of that, there were many people who claimed to be Anastasia at that time. So anesthesia is completely different from anesthesia. Please remember that. I am talking about this with anesthetists who sometimes pronounce the word wrongly. So So this is how anesthesia came along. The word anesthesia came about. Now, there was a further word. This was in Ether. There was this chapter. Now, what happened? The word spread promptly all over Europe, all over the United States, England, etc. And you wouldn't believe it, within 1 month of Morton's demonstration of this, anesthesia was being given in London. And the first operation was performed by a Dr. Liston, an amputation. And you will be surprised to remember, I don't know if I've told you that, the one who assisted him and stood by was no other than Lister, the great Lister of whom we talked about. That's right. So it's worth remembering that. It's just a strange coincidence, but it is so. Anyway, in the United Kingdom, there was a gynecologist called Simpson, and he said ether is quite irritating, and he discovered, or he rather experimented with chloroform, which had been discovered by a German sometime earlier. And he thought of giving chloroform to all individuals when pregnancy were delivering. They should be giving chloroform at the time of delivery so that they would have no labor pains. So there was a great uproar. There was a great uproar from the clergy. They said that getting pain during delivery is the natural thing. It has been ordained by God. Does not the book of Genesis say that it is with pangs that you shall give birth to children? You can't do that, they told Simpson. And surprisingly, the medical societies in America all agreed with the clergy. They said, yes, being in labor and having pain whilst giving birth to children is a natural thing. You should not suppress that. It's not to be suppressed. Let it come naturally. So Simpson very sarcastically replied both to the clergy and to the American Association. To the clergy he said, well, if that be so, don't you realize that God first put Adam to sleep, then he took out his rib, and from his rib he made Eve, so he must have anesthetized. And to the association, the medical association said, you want to do everything naturally, isn't it? Well, next time when you come from Philadelphia to New York, please come walking, don't catch the train. Anyway, but nobody agreed with him till Queen Victoria delivered her 7th baby and she decided to take chloroform. And when she took chloroform, the whole world said, all right, now you can get chloroform. So this is how funny it was. And of course, you know, there were much advances in anesthesia. I can't go into them. I don't know much about them, except that you had cyclopropane and other drugs which came on. And there was the endotracheal tube that was in 1930, if I mistake not, by a German called Kuhn. And then ultimately there was barbiturates, discovery of barbiturates, discovery of pentothal, and finally the discovery of muscle relaxants. Discovery of muscle relaxants thought of, because you know in South America they used to use curare to kill animals, but the animals would not be killed, but the arrows were dipped in curare, and when shot, the animal was shot, the animal would not be killed but would be paralyzed. So it is that which set the minds working, and they started working on muscle relaxants. And of course now the anesthetist is a remarkable man, from a frightened creature pouring ether down a handkerchief, then down a mask, and now he has multiple panels at his disposal, multiple anesthetic agents which he can use, and he works in tandem with the surgeon, and anesthesiology and the anesthesia has evolved in tandem with surgery and surgical expertise. I think it remains one of the greatest discoveries ever made in medicine. All right? Thank you.